transformed? Wedding was in college. I was shocked.
Are you converted Catholic?
No.
Okay.
JT, how we doing today?
DT9, we're live. Good morning. How are you?
That's why I answer the phone that way now.
Go for Nikki. Sure.
Just going, making sure here. How are you, buddy? Good morning.
Doing well, man. Doing well. Just ready for this wet weather to get out of Baton Rouge. But, man, it's been like the great flood again, right?
It doesn't let up. It doesn't let up. LSU last night. Dougie, I was a little concerned about that going into last night's game just because of the reputation that Louisiana Tech was coming to South Louisiana with last night. But I thought that was a very positive night for LSU to have to claw back and get the win 16-8. What did you make of last night's performance from LSU?
Well, I saw a lot of positives there. You know, they beat La Tech pretty good on the third game of the season too, way back when, I think 14-6, 14-7, something like that. You know, and I think it was clear the difference between the two schools is, you know, after that front guy, they ran out there, their pitching just wasn't quite as deep, you know, after that guy, but, it was interesting last night. Some things happened. Of course, some players got pulled out of the game. Thompson, DiGiacomo, and Wyeth all started, but got pulled even before their first at-bats. And Mitchell Sanford, Zach Arnold, and Braden Doty filled in. Those guys, by the way, combined for like 5 hits and 8 RBIs. Great to watch. Doty just missed a homer late in the game and hit the top of the wall. Umpire actually called it a home run, but they called it back to a triple. But it was one of those great moments in sports where a guy like Braden Doty, who's caught hundreds, if not thousands, of bullpens and just kind of been always in the background, had that moment. The whole team came out of the dugout as if it was a walk-off home run for the World Series, which is great to see when that type of stuff happens. But all in all, it was a great win. You know, multiple players with multiple RBIs. And I think the biggest difference that I noticed last night is when LSU fell behind 1-2, 0-2, they were really good at extending those at-bats. They would take some bad swings, but just get a piece of the ball to stay alive and wait for that mistake. And they were able to capitalize on that many times last night. I know Dugas had a couple hits with two strikes, drove the ball the other way a couple times, drove in some runs. But multiple players were able to get that accomplished last night. So it was a huge win for LSU. I mean, I can't remember the last time that a midweek game has been so important to play, right? Yeah, like not necessarily postseason implications, not necessarily going to make or break anyone, but with both teams' RPI so high, LSU got a little bit of a taste of why those other schools are always so anxious to play the Tigers, because normally the shoe's on the other foot. LSU has the high RPI and the good ranking. And of course, those teams coming here and playing that quality opponent matters. So it was an interesting game from that perspective last night, but I was thrilled to see the Tigers get the win. And the way that they did it, you know, La Tech started off scoring runs in each of the first 5 innings. The Tigers were shut out in the first 2 innings, but after that, innings 3 through 7, 5 straight innings that LSU was able to score. So it was a back-and-forth game until the end, but I think the better team actually won. And it was a great, great bit of momentum to gain headed into this weekend against Alabama at the Box. You know, listen, LSU rattles off 6 straight here and runs the table, partner. They're going to end up 500 in the SEC, which would be such an amazing accomplishment. And, look, it's been a tough year, but here we are with 2 weeks left, and they still have the chance to finish at 500 in what has been an incredibly difficult SEC season.
Doug Thompson of the LSU Sports Radio Network joining us here in the Jordy Collada Show, breaking down LSU baseball. Tigers win last night, 16-8, 3-game set versus Alabama coming up this weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. LSU had 17 hits last night. Trey Morgan had 4 of them, Doug. Last 2 out of the 3 weeks, Morgan's the SEC freshman of the week. Perspective on how good Morgan is and just what type of player and what he brings to the everyday lineup.
I'm so glad you asked that. Had you not, I was going to somehow figure out a way to work in Trey Morgan and start to look for some perspective on what this freshman season is starting to unfold as. I mean, this kid was at 363 last night, his batting average going into the game. With the 4 hits last night, he moves up now to 375. I've got to get my guy Todd Poli on the highest batting average from a freshman. I think Todd Walker is way up there, 398, maybe even 400 as a freshman. I think Eddie Furness had a great freshman as well. Look at the names I'm mentioning, yeah, right? These guys are on the Raptors. Their numbers are retired, right? So to say that Dylan Cruz and Trey Morgan, you know, we talked at the beginning of the year that you're lucky to have one freshman that can slide into the box and, you know, have all the things required to play, including the thick skin, the short memory, on top of all the attributes you need, the physical abilities, right? This year to have two guys come in and lead the team in hitting. I mean, Cruz is at 350 something and Morgan's at 375. It's been incredible to watch, and man, what a great future LSU has, not only with those two guys, there's some others that we haven't seen as much of, but man, they have a lot, tons of big freshman arms that are only going to get better and better as the, you know, as time goes on.
You kind of dovetailed into my question that I wanted to ask. You talked about LSU extending at bats and kind of taking a different approach at the plate. Is that a Trey Morgan effect? Because he's done that all year where he's kind of choked up and always been ready to hit with two strikes. Do you think the rest of LSU has kind of taken notice in that approach?
Well, perhaps, right? You know, that leadoff guy gets it going, right? So what I love about Trey Morgan, he's got an incredible eye. He's got a very good feel for the strike zone. When he takes pitches, they are usually balls. And even more so, he gets in that batter's box ready to hit. If that first pitch is a hittable pitch, he's going to take a big cut at it, and a lot of times he's going to connect. And I really like Trey Morgan's approach. So perhaps that's, you know, some guys have taken that on, you know, and seen him and kind of followed suit. Hitting is contagious, as they say. But I think all in all, last night was probably – 1 through 9, and then even 10, 11, and 12 with the subs that got in there. I think it was the best, you know, overall hitting performance for LSU this season in a game.
Dougie, what do you make of the pitching storylines going into this weekend versus Alabama? It seems like Labus and obviously Marceau have steadied the pace for LSU up top. What have you made of the arms behind those guys?
Well, first of all, I think if Mikhail Hilliard doesn't get the ball on Sunday, something wrong. I mean, that kid has earned it. His outing this last Sunday was dang near heroic. I mean, to get into the eighth, ninth inning after having only been to, you know, 51, 60 pitches throughout the season, you know, I'll take Mikhail Hilliard any day on the weekend. So you're right. I think that Marceau and Labus have really started to pitch in quote-unquote midseason form. And with Mikhail Hilliard, as good as he's been on that back end, you know, I'm excited about the starters. I think that right now we have the most consistent starting staff that we've had all season. And then I think there's some guys like Hasty and others that we've seen a lot out of the bullpen that are getting tons of great experience, but they're also getting outs. So I really don't think that pitching is a big problem for LSU, especially if they're able to continue to score runs the way that they are. I think they have plenty of depth running into this last two weekends. So, man, I'm hopeful. Look, and if you've been watching LSU baseball, Jordy, I know you have for the last 10, 15 years. The one thing that I've always made note of with Paul Mainieri's teams, regardless of their level of skill, he will have that team playing their best baseball coming down the home stretch. He always has. It's been kind of a signature, a trademark of Paul Mainieri-led teams. So I expect this team to play lights out coming down the home stretch. Do I put it past Paul Mainieri to run the table and win six in a row? No. Do I think that's going to be tough? Of course. But four out of six of the next one I think is definitely possible, and that will make postseason play very interesting. But even with 13 wins, Jordy, you got to assume that the toughest schedule in the country will mean something to the committee who chooses, you know, the teams that go.
Monday, May 24th will be a special day for the LSU baseball community when Hold the Rope debuts on the SEC Network, and that will detail Skip Bertman turning LSU baseball into the powerhouse that it is today. Doug, it is obvious that you are one of Skip's favorites when he talks about the long list of players that came through LSU during his many years of leading the program. Can you talk about what – I don't want to ask you what Skip means to you, because you could probably go on for 3 hours on a podcast and not let up, but just what that night will mean to the LSU baseball community and how much people are looking forward to this for Skip that night.
You know, long overdue, well-deserved. I wish it was more than a 30-minute or hour special. I think there could be a great movie about Skip Bertman. Personally, what he means to me, you know, he's as close to me as any grandfather that I've ever had. When I was born, one of my grandfathers was already deceased. The other passed away when I was very young. So Skip means an incredible amount to me, but it's not just me. There's hundreds of guys that feel the same way about him. You know, we imitate him every day. We tell stories about him every day. He truly, look, as a coach, Jordy, and I know you know this, right? Like, you're not really worried about the 11-year-old team. Well, you may be, but the 11-year-old winning the championship, I guess as a goal is important. But as a coach, you know, our goal is really to make these kids better kids when they're, you know, better people when they're 30 years old, right? Yeah. And it's easy to say that as a coach, but it's very difficult to keep that focus that you're trying to develop people, not just players. And Skip Bertman obviously did that throughout his career. You can see that by the adulation when you talk to any of his former players. He not only prepared us for the field, but he prepared us for life. He's such a special human. I mean, he's so unusual in so many ways that it's just long overdue, and I'm so excited about it. And, you know, we love him so much, and I'm just glad that it's finally happening to where we can watch this special. I think I heard over 200 people, were interviewed for this deal. So you can see how much he's regarded and how much he's loved just by that alone. And, man, I appreciate you bringing that up. I'm very excited about May 24th, and I look forward to it. I can't wait for it. I can't wait to watch about 10 of the reruns when they come on.
Yeah, no, it's going to be fantastic. And you don't have to tell the story, because I tried to tell it secondhand after I heard it from you, and I couldn't go into all the details. But 1995 Skip Bertman is Skip Bertman, right? I mean, he is the legend in 1995, and that's when he was recruiting you. Can you just let our listeners in on a little bit of that recruiting story, the first time he met you and he asked you to make those pitches, and he's standing behind you as the legendary Skip Bertman? I don't mean to put you on the spot. You can tell me to piss off if you want. But
No. I think what you're talking about is after I'd signed the first bullpen that I was throwing at LSU, I'd never really seen Coach Bertman yet on the field. And it was the back bullpen at the old box down the right field line. Some remember it wasn't the one on the field, the one behind the stage, the bleacher where the starting pitcher would warm up. And he walked in the bullpen. He was smoking a cigar. You know, I was starstruck, as an 18-year-old could be. As you mentioned, he was a legend already. And, I was about finished with my bullpen, and he asked me to throw two pitches. And it was, a fastball and a curveball and to a certain location. And when I did that, he said, okay, that's enough. Listen, we can win championships if you're able to do that when I ask you to. So you got to trust me. You know, it was just an amazing moment for him to see, two pitches and give me the confidence right then that that's good enough to pitch here. Because, of course, I'm a JUCO transfer. There's 12 guys on the pitching staff. They're all taller than me. They all throw harder than me. And for him to be able to walk back there and see that just gave me an incredible amount of confidence. And who knows, without that, if I would have ever been able to, pitch the way that I was able to, or the opportunity, get the opportunities that I did at LSU. So he was great at that. He was the master motivator. He didn't use the same technique on everyone, which I think, as a leader is important, right? Everyone doesn't beat to the same drum. So some leaders make the mistake of trying to make everyone march to their orders as opposed to finding out what makes each individual march the best, right? And he was the absolute best at that. He's a legend. And, so happy that I got to know him. My kids, of course, have heard many stories and have got to meet him many times. But, we talked about Kim Mulkey being hired and how it was such a great hire for the university. And it's really the first legendary hire that LSU has made. But LSU's made a couple of people legends. Skip Bertman's at the top of that list.
Summer of 1983. LSU was never the same after the hire that they made with Skip Bertman. Doug Thompson, fast forward just a year later after that bullpen session, you will always have that monumental moment that LSU fans will see forever of Thompson celebrating the fourth national championship in 1997 with his hands raised over his head on the Omaha pitching mound. Such a just a beautiful time in LSU athletics and LSU baseball that will be relived on Hold the Rope SEC Network, debuting Monday, May 24th at 6 p.m. And can't wait for it. Doug, thanks as always for the time and the knowledge this morning. Have a great call this weekend.
All right, buddy. You guys have a good one.
All right, man.
Thanks,
see you.
George.
There is DT9, Doug Thompson, checking in this morning. I could listen to rants, listen to Doug, listen to those lifers, those LSU all-timers tell Skip Bertman stories. I'm telling you, when Thompson told me that story for the first time, I nearly was in tears because of how he told it, in the sense of the trust angle of getting Skip Bertman's trust in that moment, and really just kind of being an arrogant kid at the time that thought he was a very well accomplished athlete, which he was. I mean, Doug Thompson is one of these. Doug was the field goal kicker on his junior college team because he was kicking footballs after baseball workouts one day, and the football coach was like, "Say what?
You can do this too.
Put a uniform in this kid."
I don't have a quarterback.
Very, just a very natural athlete. He's a very good athlete. And to hear him in that moment when Bertman walks behind him and he's puffing on the cigar right behind him and he's kind of tense and tight, and he tells him to throw these two pitches, and he imitates his voice and he imitates his gestures and his hands, and he does all of the Skip Bertman quirks. But to hear what the message and the lesson was in that moment, and to hear what Thompson turned out to be for Skip. I mean, if you hear Skip talk about Doug, he was almost like this security blanket for him. I mean, he would tell stories like, we could put Thompson out there and just beat him if we need to. I mean, he had this confidence and security with Doug during that time of LSU baseball, where Doug is he's just a very good resource on Skip stories, because you can hear Skip is almost like a dad to him. I mean, the way that he treats him, the way that they have respect for one another, and even the lessons. If you go and eat lunch with him today, they still have that bullpen relationship where Doug's even almost in kind of awe that Skip cares this much about him.
Well, how could you not? I mean? How could you not be, right? After this guy like swaggers in with a cigar in his mouth and puffing smoke, and he's won, you know, he's got natty championships under the belt. He goes, "Give me a fastball, curveball. Yeah. All right, you can do that. We can win." It's like, oh, okay. Sure.
But gotcha, I mean, the stories they have on Skip.
What about the way he's a leader? He's saying how he didn't want to just do it one way. He had to find how everyone clicked.
An absolute orchestrator.
That is such
an underrated.
I think that's got to be his best attribute as a coach, because there were so many people that would come in and tell those similar. I mean, Ryan, the growth of Ryan Terrio, of what he went through, and Skip, and what Skip coached Ryan Terrio as hard as he probably coached anybody, because he knew Terrio since he was 6 years old, because he was going to Skip Bertman camps growing up in Baton Rouge, and Skip said, "That kid's going to be our shortstop when he's in college." I mean, he recognized that when he was 10, 12, and he was able to really press down on Terrio,
because he knew he could take it.
And Terrio says to this day, "I don't make it through the minor leagues. I don't make it through those dog days of being a pro baseball player without going back to my lessons of what I learned from Skip Bertman."
Wow.
And Skip Bertman couldn't treat Doug Thompson like he treated Ryan Terrio.
Exactly.
He couldn't treat Cedric Harris, his star center fielder, the way that he treated other guys. I mean, the way that he coached Russ Johnson and Todd Walker. Todd Walker is a generational type player. They have still yet to have a real player like Todd Walker come through there. And I mean, Todd Walker tells stories about how his freshman season, he's freshman All-American, he's the best player in the sport. He pretty much had a Chris Jackson basketball freshman season on the baseball field. Like, I mean, he essentially averaged 30.
You know what I mean? Stingley Jr.
Yeah, I mean,
type
year. Like, Chris Jackson averaged 30 as a freshman. Todd Walker was the best player in the sport as a freshman. And Walker tells a story how, like, Bertman brings him in after the season, and he thinks Bertman's going to, like, offer him more of a scholarship, and he takes some of his scholarship away from him to give him to a pitcher that he's got to have. And it was Walker kind of learning that, man, as good as I am and as much as I mean to this program, this guy will never let me He'll never let me believe that. He'll always keep me humble.
Wow.
And, you know, I mean, just he can't coach Ronnie Rance the way he coached Todd Walker. You know, I mean, Ronnie Rance's stories on I mean, we've got to get Rance to tell the story about when they went to Vegas. Have you ever heard that story? When they went to play, when they went to Vegas and him and his roommate snuck out of the of their hotel and they went down to the casino.
And they get
and they
popped.
Start playing. They put their suits on. They go down there. They're thinking
that, they're heavy hitters.
They got a pot to piss in. College kids. And Skip and Smoke, the assistant coach, are at the craps table, like two down. And Burtman walks up behind him and tells Rance, "You're done. You're done for the weekend." And Rance was supposed to be, like, making the start on Sunday. He had his parents fly in from Alexandria. They were up in Las Vegas. And to this day, Rance still has the life lesson that he took away from it.
Well, yeah, they were and they had spotted the coaches before they had spotted them, right. Or so they thought. So they were trying to sneak out the casino like one at a time their suit jackets on. So they're trying to make
a
move.
Right. That's right.
And I think Rance was the last one left. He goes, "Hey, you don't even worry about it. You're not playing tomorrow. Stay as long as you want."
That's right.